As many as who are led by the Holy Spirit, these are the sons of God. That's what the Apostle Paul wrote in Romans chapter 8. He's writing to a Gentile congregation. And he's saying, if you're led by the Holy Spirit, you are the children of God, by which your own mind, your own spirit testifies to what the Holy Spirit has done and making you a child of God. It is not the children of the flesh who are heirs according to the promise. That's what we see in Romans chapter 9, the very next chapter. Paul is lamenting. He's saying, I could wish myself to be accursed because my beloved brethren in the natural, my countrymen, my kinsmen, have been blinded, have been veiled to the gospel of Jesus Christ. And only a remnant has seen and believed and received the promise. And when you receive the promise, it means you've entered into Abraham's covenant. Abraham's covenant is a covenant of promise. Sinai is not the covenant of promise. The children of Israel rejected Abraham's covenant at Sinai and was given another covenant until the promised seed should come. That promised seed was the Messiah, Yeshua, salvation, son of David. That's why Jesus told Nicodemus, when Nicodemus came to him in John chapter 3, he came to him at night because he was a great teacher. He was a great rabbi. And they weren't so sure about this Jesus yet. They were debating about him, but they could not deny the great miracles he was doing. So they came to him. He came to him at night so that others wouldn't say, hey, what are you doing over there seeing Jesus? Weren't you over there seeing Yeshua? What are you doing over there seeing him? We don't know about that guy yet. But he came, and you know what he really wanted to know? He really wanted to know, are you the Messiah? Are you the promised one? Are you the one that we are looking for? Are you the one that's going to restore sovereignty to Israel? Are you the one that's going to be the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords and break the yoke that had been on us from the time of Babylon, the Medo-Persian Empire, Greece, and now Rome? Are you the one? Are you our deliverer, our King, our Messiah, the Anointed One? Now, he never said any of that. He never got any of it out. Nicodemus just came to Jesus, but Jesus knew what he wanted. He came to Jesus and he said, good teacher, we know that you're a man from God because no one could do these great things, these miracles, unless God be with them. And Jesus just stopped him right there and said, Nicodemus, you must be born again to see the kingdom of God. You think that you're an heir of the kingdom because you're born of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. But I'm telling you, you must be born of the Spirit. Oh, yes, you have the fleshly lineage, genealogy, but that will profit you nothing because flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. That's what we see in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. Whether you're Jew or Gentile, barbarian, Greek, it doesn't matter. As far as entering the kingdom of God, unless you're born of the Spirit, unless you're born of the Holy One, unless you're born of the promised seed. That's why in Romans chapter 9, Paul said, it's not those who are born of Israel who are the descendants, but those born according to the promise. And he just said, he quoted the scripture in Isaiah, that after Isaac shall your descendants be named. Why Isaac? Why not Jacob? Because Isaac is the child of promise. Amen? He is the child of promise. Now, you are children of Abraham. That's what Paul told the Galatians. You're Abraham's offspring if you've been born of the Holy Seed. If you've been born of the Holy Spirit. In Galatians 3, verse 10, the apostle said, that the gospel was preached to Abraham beforehand, in that you would be saved, and that all nations would be, have access to the promise. To the Jew first, see, God has an order, to the Jew first, and then to you. It's always to the Jew first, or to the Israelite first. Jew is just one tribe, but after the split in about 900 B.C., the northern kingdom, the 10 tribes, went off into their own worship. Only Judah and Benjamin, with some of the Levites, were able to keep some of their faith and their belief in God. Now, you and I are, allegorically speaking, born according to the promised seed, we are then not only children of God, but we are children of Abraham and Sarah. We should not only look to the apostles, but look to the father of the faithful, Father Abraham. He is the father of the faithful. He is an example to us. When God called him out of Ur, of the Chaldeans, and Ur was the most magnificent city of ancient times. In actuality, to be a citizen of Ur, nothing could be greater than being a citizen of Ur, actually, really. Not even Rome, not even being a citizen of Rome, although that had many benefits, except being a citizen of the kingdom of God. Because when they excavated Ur in the early 20s, and they really got down to it and discovered so many things in 1927, they found that this city was a city of absolute luxury, that the average person lived in a two-story, 14-room villa with indoor plumbing, with guest rooms. They found libraries. They found many artifacts. They found many statuaries of dignitaries. And they all had pleasant countenances on their faces with hands extended. There was no record of war. How would you like to live in a place where there's no record of war? There was no wall around the city. Think about that. Now, this is the greatest city of ancient times. Magnificent. Advanced. And they knew, they found the city of Ur. When they went down and see that the cities had been built on top of it, city after city. But after they got down to the base, they found an advanced city. And they found brick with the actual word Ur stamped in them and called in. So they knew they had found the ancient city. And they were shocked at what they found. But it was that city where a prominent citizen, an astronomer, the one who studied the stars and who had come to the conclusion that the stars and the constellations and the sun is not God, but testifies that there is a God. It gives testimony that there is a creator that created all things. That he looked and he saw the creatures of nature, and he did not see a divine nature in them, but he knew that a divine being had created them. Amen. And that man was Abraham. And he was a prominent citizen in the most prominent city of all time. And yet God called him one day because he was seeking the creator, not the creation. And God called him and he said, "You, Abraham, come out. Come out." Abraham was a man of great riches. He said, "Come out and you live with me in the desert." Money ain't worth much in the desert. Might as well build a fire with it if it's made out of paper. Amen. You live with me in the desert. And you know, and Abraham did not deny the Lord. He came out. He left everything. And then when God promised him a son and that came about, God said, "You give me that son." And he was willing to do it. Brethren, there is order. There was a time for Abraham to be in the city of Ur. There was a time for him to be in the darkness and a time for him to come to the light. was a time for him to leave, come into the desert. There was a time when for Isaac to be born, the child of promise. There is order. There's order in the universe, amen. I think most people would be surprised if you were to ask them, what do you believe God's passion is? I mean, if you could get it down to the simplest explanation, what is God's passion? What is it that means more to him than anything else? And you'd have to say, whatever it is that is necessary for his will and his purpose to be accomplished, to be perfected, wouldn't you say? I've come to the conclusion that God's passion is order. God is love. God has wrath. God is just. God is merciful. God is forgiving. But God's passion is order. That's his passion. And I want you to think for a moment. Everything that God has done since the fall has been to restore order. Did God not create order in the universe? Does the Bible and Psalms not say that he placed the constellations in their appointed place? That he has appointed places, appointed people, appointed times? He has appointed festivals, you see, and they come in order. Everything you see that God has made that is working right is in proper order. And whenever you see something in confusion or something that is not properly working, something is out of order, you see. God's passion is order. And if we're going to be God's people, and see, Abraham knew that. That's why he left Ur. He knew that it was time for him to go to the desert. He didn't complain in the desert. Think about it. Who's he got the influence in the desert? Who's he got to talk to besides his wife and his servants in the desert? I mean, there's no other scientists or astronomers to hobnob with in the desert. Is there? And it was a very dangerous place. In Ur, he was very safe. But according to oral history, that in the desert during that time, it was a very dangerous and treacherous place where bandits would come out of nowhere and just come and rob and pillage. And we see that, you know, some of that happened during the time of Lot, when Lot was captured and Abraham had to go rescue him. God's passion is order. If your body was not, if your eye was not working, if the cones in your eyes were not working in proper order right now, you would not be able to see. You wouldn't see in color. If your heart was not beating in order, you'd die. You see, you would faint, you'd pass out, you'd die. If your lungs weren't breathing in order, you'd pass out because there'd be no oxygen to get to your brain. Everything has to work in order. Do you put both feet forward or do you lead with one? There's an order in it. Left, right, right, left. You don't go right, right. Try it, you'll fall down. It doesn't work. Do you walk backwards or you walk frontwards? Do you think you do things in order? There is order everywhere in that God has created. God created order in the very beginning, didn't he? Well, let's go back even farther than that. Do you think God has order in heaven? Do you think he has divine order in heaven? Do you think every angel has his appointed assignment? This finger has an assignment. It's in its proper place. You know why? Because God placed it there. I didn't place it there. Now, I could cut this one off over here and sew it on over this hand. You know what? It wouldn't work. And then this hand would be damaged. But this little finger has no rivals, none. It's the best at what it does. This finger, got no rivals either. Look, Hook'em Horns. We don't even like the Longhorns, do we? But anyway, this little finger has no rivals. You know, we've kind of got over that since the Razorbacks been out of the Southwest Conference. And we've beaten Texas, I think, three or four out of the last five times we played them. So we don't hate Texas as much as we used to. But they used to beat us all the time in football, you know, the Razorbacks. But when something is in its place, it's working perfectly, and it has no rival. But just think about how this building was made. It was made in order. When God told Moses to instructing the Israelites how to build the tabernacle, he told them exactly what to do. He told them how many fasteners on the curtains there should be, how many rings on the curtains. He told them what size the curtain should be. He told them how big the tabernacle should be. He told them what color everything should be. Everything had a specific order. He told them what to make and what order to make it in. When he ordained the priesthood, he told them what to do and what to do first. There was order. See, God's passion is order. Now, let's think about that for a minute. Well, let's go over to Ezekiel chapter 28. Let's go before the fall of man, all the way back to the fall of Lucifer. And we're going to see that Lucifer fell. You know why he fell? Somebody tell me. Because he left his order. Amen? He left his order. Why did the angels, the fallen angels, fall? Because what do we see in Jude? They left their proper abode. They left their place. Amen? Marriages fail. You know why marriages fail? Because a wife gets out of place. Or a husband gets out of place, or they, most cases, they both get out of place. Amen? Children go astray. Why? Because they are out of order. They don't honor and obey their parents. They don't obey the fifth commandment. The first commandment regarding man's responsibility to man. Now, this is a prophecy of the king of Tyre, but we understand it's not talking about a natural king. The natural king was not in Eden. Amen. And was not the anointed cherub that covereth. So we understand that this is allegorically speaking, and it's actually referring to Lucifer. Let's begin in verse 12. Son of man, take up a lamentation over the king of Tyre and say to him, this is what the Lord says. You had the seal of perfection. Now, the seal of perfection means that, actually in the Hebrew, it means that you were a pattern that was sealed. In other words, you don't make a pattern unless you're going to replicate it. When God created Lucifer, he created Lucifer as a prototype. We don't understand. We don't know why. I don't know why. I don't know what a prototype of, but he was a seal of perfection. In other words, and that word seal is signet. And you know what signet is? It is like a ring that has the image of whoever is the king or the ruler. In this case, it's God himself. So this king of Tyre had the seal of perfection. In other words, he was sealed with the signet of God with perfection, and he possessed the signet of God. That means he was second only to God in heaven. Notice, full of wisdom and perfect in beauty. Notice verse 13, you were in Eden, the garden of God. So let us know it's not talking about a person. But allegorically speaking, it's speaking about the anointed cherub or Lucifer. You were in Eden, the garden of God. Every precious stone was your covering, the ruby, the topaz, and the diamond, the beryl, the onyx, and the jasper, the lapis lazuli, the turquoise, and the emerald, and the gold, the workmanship of your settings and sockets was in you. On the day that you were created, they were prepared. So he was magnificent in his beauty, and God made him that way. You were the anointed cherub who covers, and that word in in Hebrew means guards, not just cover, but guards the throne of God, overshadows it. And I placed you there. You were on the holy mountain of God. You walked in the midst of the stones of fire. You were blameless in your ways from the days you were created until unrighteousness was found in you. By the abundance of your trade, you were internally filled with violence, and you sinned. Therefore, I have cast you as profane. Why? Because sin was found in him. Unrighteousness was found in him. What was the unrighteousness? In his mind first, you know, the first place you step out of order is in your mind. You convince yourself that you're not out of order. The deceived are deceived. Those who deceive are deceived themselves. That's what Paul told Timothy. You will believe whatever you want to believe. Do you hear what I'm saying? Whatever you want to believe, that's what you're going to believe. If you have it in your mind that you want to believe a certain thing, you will. Oh, yes, you will. Because when you desire that above all else, when you desire something other than the truth. Now, if you desire the truth, if you say, Lord, teach me your truth. Teach me your ways. Show me your will, and I will follow it. I will lay down my will. I'll lay down my desires, my wants, and I'll walk in your way. And when you pray that, you better be ready, because God will. And it may not be anything you like. Maybe some things that you don't like. You know, most people, they receive Christ and they're walking along just fine until they stumble. What do you think they stumble over? Somebody tell me. The Word. They stumble over the Word. They come across the Word of God, something they don't like. They're uncomfortable there. They don't like that Word. They wish it didn't say that. Surely it doesn't mean that. They begin to think. And a spirit will come along, and another person will come along, and will comfort them in the same sense. I don't think that means that. I don't think God really means that. No, I don't think so. Or I think God does mean this, or whatever. Anyway, you leave the will of God, because you're not looking for the will of God anymore. You're looking to satisfy what you want. Satisfy your own desires, your own heart. That's always been the problem with everyone. Amen? Anybody that goes off, think about it. Anybody that falls away, what does it mean to fall away? You're falling away from the Word, the living Word. You're falling away from God, from Christ, from your Savior. For what reason? Usually because the same reason that they fell away from Jesus. What did he say? A stumbling block was laid in Zion. Now, listen, let me tell you something, brethren. Do you think that you don't have any stumbling blocks? Do you think the devil doesn't know where it is that you will potentially stumble? Do you think he does not study you? What enemy that is wiser than Daniel, according to this chapter, earlier in the chapter, it says he's wiser than Daniel. And, you know, Nebuchadnezzar said Daniel is wiser than all. He's 10 times wiser, he said, than all the men, his wise men of Babylon. Yet the king of Tyre, Lucifer, was wiser than Daniel. Our wisdom is no match for the wisdom of Lucifer. But we don't have to match him with wisdom. We obey God, we submit to God, and he will flee from us. Amen. So he says, I cast you as profane from the mountain of God, verse 16, I have destroyed you, O covering cherub, from the midst of the stones of fire. Your heart was lifted up because of your beauty. You corrupted your wisdom by reason of your splendor. Now that's interesting right there, isn't it? How was his wisdom corrupted? By reason. You know, if you go on Facebook, you'll see a lot of people's wisdom, or the wisdom of God, has been corrupted by reason. People begin to say, well, God is a God of love, therefore, dot, dot, dot. Therefore, he would never send me to hell. Therefore, he will forgive me. You see? So they leave the sure word of God that says all sinners will be cast into the lake of fire. If you don't, salvation is only in Christ. If you don't have him, you don't have salvation. Now, that's what the word of God says. But people will begin to use philosophy. They'll be again, I don't really think that's, well, yeah, but see, God is love. There was someone here a while back that was mentioning, and he's a Christian, supposed to be a Christian anyway. He claims to be a Christian, and he's a well-known person around here, a well-known Christian musician. And something came up about homosexuality. Some person that was practicing homosexuality had mentioned that some church he was going to and playing the piano in, they said, you can't do that anymore. Well, of course he can't. Not if he's going to practice any kind of sin. If you're going to practice sin, you can't be a part of serving the church of God. So anyway, this guy wanted to comfort him. And so there's a long discussion, well over 100 comments about homosexuality. And most of them were saying, well, God, you know, God made you that way. God, you know, forgives, and that you're not wrong. And they just took the party line that we have out here in order to be politically correct. But you know what? The Word of God has not changed. The Word of God still says all sinners, and specifically says by name, homosexuals will have their part in the lake of fire. So what good does it do to comfort someone in sin when that sin is going to destroy them? If you care, you want to bring them out of that sin. That's not going to be popular. I mean, to go up to someone and say, I'm not saying one sin is greater than another sin, but any sex outside of marriage is sin and punishable by death in the lake of fire. And that means you, friend. So, you know, you either turn away from it and live, or you continue in it and perish. But I'm not going to comfort you there. Amen. But wisdom is corrupted by reason. That's usually what happens. People begin to reason. They'll take a principle. God is love. So God is just. God is forgiving. Therefore, he'll forgive me. Well, he forgives those who repent. Amen. That's what the word says. But they leave that part out and they'll begin to reason until they feel comfortable where they are. You corrupted your wisdom by reason of your splendor. I cast you to the ground. I put you before kings that they may see you. By the multitude of your iniquities and the unrighteousness of your trade, you profaned your sanctuaries. Therefore, I brought fire from the midst of you. It has consumed you, and I've turned you to ashes on the earth. And that's a prophecy of what will take place. And you can see it again in Malachi chapter 4, verse 3. Now let's turn over to Jude, right before the book of Revelation. Now, notice verse 3. Now, Jude is the brother of Jesus. He's the half-brother of Jesus. He did not believe that Jesus was the Son of God. He did not believe that Jesus was the Messiah until after Jesus was resurrected. Matter of fact, in the book of Mark, we see that Jude and James, and along with some of the others, were with their mother Mary, there to take custody of Jesus when Jesus was facing off with the Pharisees and Sadducees. And they were going to take custody of him because they thought he had lost his senses. Now notice verse 3. This is what Jude is writing to. It's a general letter to all the churches of God. And he says, Beloved, while I was making every effort to write to you about our common salvation, I felt the necessity to write to you appealing that you contend earnestly for the faith which was once for all handed down to the saints. Now, did you hear what he's just saying? He's saying, look, brethren, I wanted to write to you just expressing my joy and how we are saved, how we have salvation in Christ. And that's what I wanted to write to you about. But the Holy Spirit would not let me. The Holy Spirit compelled me to write to you that you contend earnestly for the faith which was once and for all delivered to the saints by the apostles. And he goes on to say, why? Because certain persons have crept in unnoticed, those who were long beforehand marked out for this condemnation, ungodly persons who turn the grace of our God into licentiousness and deny our only Master and Lord Jesus Christ. It's where people say, hey, you know what? We're under grace, therefore we don't have to keep God's law. Well, Ephesians chapter 2 says, by grace through faith you're saved, and not by works, lest anyone should boast. But he goes on to say that you were saved for works created beforehand that you should walk in them. We weren't saved to continue in lawlessness. Amen. Verse 5. Now I desire to remind you, though you know all things once and for all, that the Lord, after saving a people out of the land of Egypt, subsequently destroyed those who did not believe. Now notice verse 6. And the angels who did not keep their own domain, in other words, they got out of order. They did not keep their own domain, but abandoned their proper abode. He is kept in eternal bonds under darkness for the judgment of the great day. Just as Sodom and Gomorrah and the cities around them, since they in the same way as these indulged in gross immorality, went after strange flesh, are exhibited as an example and undergoing the punishment of eternal fire. Now notice verse 12. These are men who are hidden reefs in your love feasts, when they feast with you without fear, caring for themselves, clouds without water, carried along by winds, autumn trees, without fruit, doubly dead, uprooted. Verse 14, it was also about these men that Enoch in the seventh generation from Adam prophesied, saying, behold, the Lord came with many thousands of his holy ones to execute judgment upon all and to convict all the ungodly of their ungodly deeds. And you could just as easily put out of order, because that's what it is to be ungodly. To be out of God's will is to be out of order. Amen. You know, 1 Corinthians chapter 14, Paul said, all things, God is not a God of confusion, he said. Therefore, all things must be done in an orderly manner. See, all things must be done in order. That's God's way. It's God's way in the universe. It's God's way in the universe of your own body. It's God's way when you want to build something. It's God's way in nature. It's God's way in the family. It's God's way in the in government, in the nations, God's way in the church. It's God's way, period. Amen. He is a God of order. Turn over to Titus chapter 1. You know, one of the worst places that the Christian church is out of order is in the home. Amen? I mean, don't you see children out of order? Children are out of order. I mean, children regularly question the authority of their parents. Is that right? Isn't that common? Some of you work in daycare, and you see that. Don't you see it? Oftentimes, a general light regard for authority. You have to establish authority. Amen? When you're even in a daycare. And if you don't, you won't be able to protect those children. They won't do what you say. They can be in danger, you know, if they're not listening to you. So one of the more glaring places Where people are out of order is in the family and among just generally in people themselves. Now, notice here in Titus, verse 1, chapter 1, verse 1. Paul, a bondservant of God, an apostle of Jesus Christ, for the faith of those chosen of God and the knowledge of God, which is according to godliness, in the hope of eternal life, which God, who cannot lie, promised long ages ago, but at the proper time manifested even his word in the proclamation with which I was entrusted according to the commandment of God, our Savior. So Paul was entrusted with that gospel to preach it. Now, if he didn't do it, he didn't preach the gospel before. He was a teacher in Judaism. You know, and Jesus struck him blind on the road to Damascus and brought him out. And he said, now you're going to be a fisher of men. Now you're going to teach me. And he basically, I'm sure he did teach Paul for 3 years, we find in Arabia. And I'm sure what the Lord told him is that Moses spoke of me. Moses prophesied of me. Moses said there would be another prophet that would be greater that would come. And then he had his apostles that he sent out. Now notice verse 4. To Titus, my true child in the common faith, grace and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus, our Savior. Now this is to Titus, a faithful worker, one of Paul's men. And now notice verse 5. For this reason I left you in Crete. Now Crete is an island in the Mediterranean Sea. It's called the land of a thousand cities because there were so many towns on that little island. So he says, for this reason I left you in Crete, that you would what? That you would set in order. He set in order. In other words, until they're set in order, they're not in order. Amen? So he says, I left you there so that you would set in order what remains to be set in order, and appoint elders in every city as I directed you. And, you know, a congregation without an elder is a congregation without order. Any congregation without an elder is a congregation that is not in order. Just like any family, like two women can get married, but where is the head? Because the head of every man is Christ. The head of Christ is the Father. And the head of the woman is the man. Amen. So when now that we're having, you know, people of the same sex getting married, you can have two women and there's no head there. Amen. Now notice here. I left you there that you would set in order what remains and appoint elders in every city as I directed you. Namely, that if any man is above reproach, the husband of one wife, having children who believe, so it's strict, not accused of dissipation or belief. In other words, people who have children who don't believe, they don't qualify. And a person can't be rebellious. For the overseer must be above reproach. This is God's order. He said, now look, this is what I want you to do, Titus. We have a lot of people. We preach the gospel on this island of Crete, and a lot of people receive this, and they're meeting in their homes, but there's something that's not in order. There's no order there. You set in order what remains. Appoint elders in every city over these churches to guide and to shepherd these churches. Because a church without an elder is like sheep without a shepherd. Amen. Now, he says, now, you can't just pick anybody. Don't pick the guy who just owns a house. He has to be above reproach, as God said. He can't be self-willed, do whatever he wants. He can't be quick-tempered. He cannot be addicted to wine. Not pugnacious, which means overly argumentative. Not fond of sordid gain. He must be hospitable, loving what is good, sensible, just, devout, and self-willed. Holding fast the faithful word which is in accordance with the teaching, so that he will be able to both exhort in sound doctrine and refute those who contradict. Now, that's what was lacking, and that's what he said put in place. For there are many rebellious men, empty talkers and deceivers, especially those of the circumcision, who must be silenced because they are upsetting whole families, teaching things they should not teach for the sake of sordid gain. And in verse 16, they profess to know God, but by their deeds they deny him, being detestable and disobedient and worthless for any good deed. So God has order. God's passion is order, because if there is the very God, you know, when in the very beginning God made everything, he made everything in order. He made the Garden of Eden, and he made the man, and he made the woman. And Eve stepped out of that order when she listened to the serpent and she took that fruit. And then when she came and said, "Take and eat of this, this is good, it'll open your eyes," then Adam stepped right out of order and followed her over, and he took a big bite too. And their natural eyes were open, their fleshly eyes were open, and their spiritual eyes were veiled, you see. And God then had to set about restoring order to this world. This world is out of order. Do you think, what do we read in Isaiah chapter 11 and in Malachi, what the nature of animals are going to be like when God establishes kingdom on this earth? The lion will lay down with the lamb. The lion will eat grass. The Bible says there'll be no harm in all my holy mountain, because see, everything will be back in its proper order. You know why we have such suffering and devastating and death? It's because of disorder. Things are out of order. We were never to engage in this sin. Amen. Turn with me to 1 Peter chapter 3. You know, when King Saul was waiting on Samuel to give the offering, and the Philistine army was there, and they kept waiting on Samuel to come to give an offering and to ask God's blessing on the battle, Samuel was delayed. And as a result of that, Saul began to reason. And his wisdom that had come from God, his wisdom from the Holy Spirit, which he had the Holy Spirit, you know, began to be corrupted by his reason, just like Lucifer's was, you see. And he began to reason, well, Samuel was supposed to be here, he's not here. I have to do this. I have to take it upon myself to do this. He didn't think of it as stepping out of order, but he was stepping out of order, you see. He didn't think of it like that. Oh, he would have thought about that at first. That's why he didn't do it at first. See, but there was a reasoning process that was going on, and the reasoning was, well, Samuel didn't show up. We've got a battle. Some of my men are afraid. Some of my people are leaving. What am I to do? I can't go into battle without soldiers. I can't go into battle without giving an offering to the Lord and asking for a blessing. And so, as the king of Israel, the appointed king, chosen by God as the first king of Israel, first human king, ordained and given the Holy Spirit, he decided, I will do it myself. After all, I'm a king. And as a result of that, God rejected him. Why? Because he was out of order. Because God had not authorized him to do that. You know, it was a problem for him, though. His army was leaving. He had an enemy that was mobilizing forces to attack him. He wanted God's blessing. But you don't get God's blessing by taking things into your own hands. You don't get God's blessings by stepping out of order, you know. A wife can say, well, I remember one wife, I was saying, you know, you're out of order. You know, you're not submitting to your husband. And she said, well, and she gave me all kinds of reasons why she had to. You see, her wisdom was corrupted by reason. She began to reason about why her circumstance was different, why it was okay for her to usurp her husband's authority. Now, was her husband out of order? Absolutely. He may have been more out of order than her. He was absolutely out of order. Was he being a godly husband? No. Was he loving his wife like Christ loved the church? No, he wasn't. And I had to tell him that too. But there's never an excuse to take it into your own hands. God doesn't, you know, authorize the wife to take it. It says, win him over without a word. That's what it says. Not with words. Don't reason with him. You've already reasoned with yourself that gave you the authority to think you can reason with him. You see, you've already deceived yourself and corrupted your own wisdom by reasoning it yourself, and now you're taking a role. You're not. You're equal heirs with your husband, but you're not equal on this earth now. In the kingdom of God, there is no difference. But now there is a difference. That's according to the word of God. Amen. So we either accept it or we don't. And as it is with a lot of God's word, a lot of it's hard to accept. But King Saul was rejected because of that. Amen. Was David in order or out of order when he made a cart to carry the Ark of the Covenant on? He was out of order, wasn't he? Because why? Because God had said that that ark shall be carried on the shoulders of my appointed priests. No other way. Doesn't matter what his intentions were. It doesn't matter. And you know what? If there were no priests around, then he'd just have to leave it where it was or ask, or, you know, expect, or trust God to just supernaturally make it appear at Jerusalem, one or the other. Now here in 1 Corinthians, let's see how it should be in the family, because that's one of the main things, brethren. And as we go out and we are, listen to me, you are being an example. You hear what I'm saying? Now you hear me right now. You are being an example. You're either being a good example, an example of God's order, or you're being an example of being out of order, one or the other. But you are being an example. Every one of us is an example. Amen. Let's remember who we represent. Let's never forget who we represent. Here in 1 Peter chapter 3, notice verse 1. In the same way, you wives, be submissive to your own husbands, so that even if any of them are disobedient to the word, they may be won without a word by the behavior of their wives. Now that's what Peter, the chief apostle, under inspiration of the Holy Spirit, is saying. You know, Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, there he's talking about women speaking or teaching in church. He says, it's a shame. It's disgraceful. It's a disgrace. He gave the reason why. He said women are to be silent in church, and he said why? For they're not permitted because it is a disgrace for women to preach or teach in church. That's what he said. That's the reason why. So it's the same way in the family. Amen. In the same way, you wives, be submissive to your own husbands, so that even if any of them are disobedient to the word, you may see it. You know, I mean, I may read it up here. And you may see it and say, well, John or Joe or Fred's not measuring up to what we just read today. It says, this is the way, even if they're disobedient, that they may be won without a word by the behavior of their wives. You know, I can't worry about whether my wife, honors me. I can't be concerned about that. I've got to be concerned about, as a husband, whether I fulfill my responsibility to her and to God, whether I love her like Christ loved the church. That's my job. My job is to make her do anything. And I don't want you guys to think that your job is to make your wives do anything. It's not. That's not your job. You know, you wives have to, you have to look at these things as if you're serving Christ. And you men have to look at these things like you're serving Christ. You see, it's serving Christ. You see, we all have roles. Look, God didn't choose every nation in the world. He chose Israel. Is that right or wrong? Israel alone have I known among all the nations. He did not choose the other nations. Now it's open through the gospel for people of any nation to be saved. But for thousands of years, only Israelites were granted access to God in God's way, pretty much. Now, there were some God-fearers. There were some that would be grafted into Israel and would live as an Israelite, some of them even being circumcised, and they were welcomed in. But I'm talking about as nations, amen? Is that unfair? It's not unfair. It's God. That's the order. That's the order in which God did it. God chose Israel. Now, in the kingdom to come, there is no male nor female. There is no Jew or Greek. Amen? We're all the same in the kingdom to come. But on this earth, the Jew first. On this earth, the husband is the head. You see? On this earth, the elders are men. On this earth. In the kingdom, though, you see, so we don't need to let anything on this earth cause us to stumble. Amen? Because in the end, you know, how we deal with where God has placed us on this earth. I mean, this little finger can't help it. It's a little finger. It might as well just be the best little finger it can be. And as being the best little finger it can be, it has absolutely no rivals. It's number one at what it does. Most people do this be number one, but I mean, this is number one too. Amen? It's number one. Your eye is a lot better eye than it is an ear, and your ear is a lot better ear than it is a nose. You know, every member is special in itself. But out of order, it doesn't work. What if you called upon your eye to see? I mean, your ear to see? Well, it just would not work. It'd be out of order. Amen. We live and we submit ourselves to God as it is, as what our roles are today. Faithfully, being humble, just like Sarah was to Abraham and like Abraham was to God. And then in the kingdom, we'll have a wonderful reward. Amen. Now notice here in 1 Peter chapter 3. Now he goes on and says, verse 3, your adornment must not be merely external, braiding the hair and wearing gold jewelry or putting on dresses. But let it be the hidden person of the heart with the imperishable quality of a gentle and quiet spirit, which is precious in the sight of God. What is precious in the sight of God, you ladies? A gentle and quiet spirit. That's what God loves. Now, if you want to love God, then say, Lord, help me be gentle and quiet. That's what he's saying. Help me be gentle and quiet. Because I want to be more precious to you than I want to serve myself. Now, sometimes it's difficult. Some of us guys, are not very assertive. Some of us guys are just kind of whatever, you know, just we're not very assertive when it comes to serving, you know, our wives or others. And then, you know, we all have weaknesses and we all have to ask God, you know, to help us be the way you want us to be. Amen. Now notice, but let it be the hidden person of the heart with the imperishable quality of a gentle and quiet spirit, which is precious in the sight of God. For in this way, in former times, the holy women also, who hoped in God, used to adorn themselves, being submissive to their own husbands, just as Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord. Now, this doesn't mean they never had a fight. They did. They did have some fuss, you know. But overall, this was her natural I mean, this is what she strived to be like. As Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord, and you have become her children if you do what is right without being frightened by any fears. And so it's saying here that even in the church, letter to the church, to the ladies, you want to be Sarah's children, allegorically speaking, just as we all are Abraham's children, the father of the faithful. You husbands, in the same way, live with your wives in an understanding way as with someone weaker. A lot of times men will feed into it and they won't live with their wives as someone weaker. They'll live with their wives as someone stronger, and that's not true. Not according to the Word of God. You know, and then you create something that appears to be right, but it's wrong. You husbands, in the same way, live with your wives in an understanding way as with someone weaker, since she is a woman, and show her honor as a fellow heir of the grace of life. And notice, so that your prayers will not be hindered. Now notice verse 12. For the eyes of the Lord are toward the righteous, and his ears attend to their prayer. But the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. So it's as simple as that. Amen. Ephesians chapter 6, more on the family. You know the reason why we have so much teen pregnancy? So the reason why we have so many broken marriages and we have so many children that are running away from home and getting into all kinds of problems and sin is simply because the family is out of order. Amen? And as the church of God, our families need to be in God's order. Amen? We are to honor and obey our parents. Even if we honor our parents, even after we're old, we still honor our parents. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 1. Children, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment, with a promise, so that it will be well with you and that you may live long on the earth. Did you notice something about, there's a lot of people preach about sowing and reaping, and it's true. I mean, the Apostle Paul, of course, they're talking mostly about money, which is still also true, but they're doing it for wrong reasons usually. But have you ever noticed that whatever you sow is a lot less than what you reap? Have you noticed that? I mean, if you were to ask the farmer, just say, now, how much are you going to sow? Well, I got this bushel right here, seed. I'm going to sow that. And he said, well, what kind of harvest do you expect? Oh, about the same. Well, he wouldn't even go to the trouble, would he? Why would he do that for the same? I mean, put that in the ground, get the same out of the ground. That's just not the way it is. But the principle is what you sow creates more, creates a larger harvest than the seed that is sown. Now, brethren, it works both ways. When we sow something good, well, we reap something great. We may think, man, and I do think this way, honestly. I look at my life, my whole life, and I think, wow, I mean, I don't deserve, the blessings I've had. I just don't deserve it, and I don't. But what I've learned is that what little you sow, when it grows, and there's a harvest, whether it's in your children, your wife, your family, your business, whatever, it's a bigger harvest. You harvest a lot more than what you sow. And it's the same thing when you sow bad things. If you sow bad things, I mean, think about our health. We may sow bad things in our health when we're younger. Later on, whoa, you're harvesting some health problems, see? And you look back and say, man, I wish I hadn't cleaned those screens with that lacquer thinner and not wore any kind of mask or respirator like I did, And you look back and say, man, that's not too good on the lungs, You don't think anything about it because what happens is somebody else could walk in. We'd be cleaning those screens, those that when we used to do shirts. Somebody would just walk in the building and go, whoa, And we'd be right there over it just like this. All those paint fumes and lacquer thinner. And you know what? You gradually get accustomed to it. And that can be good and that can be bad. In that case, it was bad. You get kind of callous to how strong that is. But we need to watch what we sow, because whatever we sow is going to come back with a harvest. It's going to produce a harvest, whether it be good or bad. And it's a bigger harvest. You sow one thing, it reproduces many more things. So that's good if you produce something good. Now notice verse 4. So he says, children, obey your parents, and I promise you it will be well with you. Now honestly, my teenage years, I did not try to honor my parents. I did not try to honor and I did not try to obey them. Now, my younger years, I did. I was pretty idealistic and I wanted to be kind of like John Wayne or somebody like that, Roy Rogers. And I wanted to be a good, upstanding American and say, yes, ma'am, and no, ma'am, and all that kind of stuff. But in my teen years, I was pretty more rebellious, just kind of turned it off, just kind of did what I wanted to do. But then God called me at an early age. He called me when I was 19. And after then, I was convicted. I was convicted. And I was convicted. I need to honor. Now, by this time, I'm married. And I needed to honor my parents. And so I really would strive to honor my parents. And my dad lived with me the last 4 years of his life, I tried to honor him. I was never put him in a nursing home. Not that that's wrong. It's not wrong. I'm just saying that he didn't want to be in a nursing home. He told me that always. And so I would have done whatever I had to do to make sure he was never in there, to honor him, as a son. So as the Church of God, we need to set that kind of an example. Amen. Fathers, do not provoke your children to anger, but bring them up in the discipline and in the instruction of the Lord. In other words, how do you provoke a child to anger? Mostly by being inconsistent, by having one rule one day and another rule the next day. Or you're hypocritical. The rules don't apply to you. You know what I mean? And so we don't want to, exasperate our children. Amen. 1 Timothy chapter 2. Because God is a God of order, and that's his passion. But how much of the New Testament scriptures, the epistles, are devoted to our relationship with one another, to how the church is supposed to operate, to how the family is supposed to be? Think about that. There's a lot there. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 1. First of all, I urge that entreaties and prayers, petitions and thanksgivings be made on behalf of all men, for kings and for all who are in authority, so that we may lead a tranquil and quiet life in all godliness and dignity. And we should be praying always for the leaders of the land. This is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who desires all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. For there is one God and one mediator also between God and men, the man Christ Jesus, who gave himself as a ransom for all, the testimony given at the proper time. For this I was appointed a preacher and an apostle. I am telling the truth. I am not lying, as a teacher of the Gentiles in faith and truth. Therefore, I want men in every place to pray, lifting up holy hands without wrath and dissension. Likewise, I want women to adorn themselves with proper clothing, modestly and discreetly, not with braided hair nor gold or costly garments, but rather by means of good works, as is proper for a woman making a claim to godliness. A woman must quietly receive instruction with entire submissiveness, but I do not allow a woman to teach or exercise authority over a man, but to remain quiet. And then he goes on to say, but you know, the reason why is because Adam, basically, it's because of the law that God created after Eve sinned in the very beginning. But this is God's order in the family, and that's God's order in the church. And so, if we're going to have a, if we're going to be the church of God, we need to be an example of how God's order stands in the church. And not go outside that order. Amen? Nothing good will come out of going outside the order of God. Amen? Has anything ever good come out of going outside God's order? Never. It's never good. It may look good, but it's not good. Never good. Amen? 1 Corinthians chapter 12. But see what you see even out here in the Christian church. You see people out of order. First of all, the Bible also says that not to lay hands upon a young convert. And a lot of times a young convert, a young man comes in, and you know, he suddenly, he's got a desire he wants to do. He wants to go out. He wants to preach. I've talked to him so many times. I told you, I get 2,000 emails a day. And you deal with people. Soon as they receive Christ, they want to go out and they want to start. Look, you need to go out simply with your testimony. Go out with your testimony. Not go out. There's these kids that go out preaching the Bible they haven't even read through. They haven't even read through the Bible. They think they know what it says already because they've heard people say certain things, and they know some things, but they're in error too. And they'll find out later on that some things they thought was true is not. Amen? Just like we all do. But when a young man does that, see, he wants to, he's energized. He wants to do something, so he runs to do it, but God didn't send him. We all want to do something. But the first thing we need to want to do is to do what God says to do. If we're going to be God's people, let's do what God says to do. If we're going to be His church, let's let Christ be the head of the church. And let Christ tell us what to do. And if He says, you do this and you don't do that, then okay. And if He says to this one over here, you can do this, but you can't do that, your will be done. It's your church. I'm just a member of your body. I'm just a little finger. Or I'm just a lung, or I'm just a liver, or I'm just a kidney. You know, it's not about me, it's about Him, and it's about the body. And about God's body working properly, amen? And that's what 1 Corinthians 12 is about. Michael mentioned a little bit when he was saying the proper working of the body. That, you know, he's saying here in 1 Corinthians 12 that there's many different gifts. And to each one is given the manifestation of a spiritual gift for the common good. It names what some of them are. Verse 11, it says, but one and the same Spirit works all things, distributing to each one individually, just as He wills. For even as the members, as a body is one and yet has many members, and all the members of the body, though they are many, are one body. So also is Christ. For by one Spirit we were all baptized into one body, whether Jews or Greeks, whether slaves or free, and we were all made to drink of one Spirit. For the body is not one member, but many. If the foot says, I am not a foot because I'm not a part of the body, is this not for this reason any less part of the body? And if the ear says, because I'm not an eye, I am not a part of the body, it is not for this reason any the less a part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the hearing be? If the whole were hearing, where would the sense of smell be? But now God has placed the members, each one of them, in the body, notice, as He desired. Now, what you always have, just like I was talking about, a young man just come to the faith, maybe he don't like where he is in the body. Maybe he wants to be function as another part of the body. But he can't function as another part of the body and be in the will of God. He can only function in the part of the body that God places him in if he's going to be in the will of God and in proper order. And God's passion is order. Everything that is wrong in this world is because it's out of order. Amen. The whole creation is out of order. Okay, verse 18. But now God has placed the members, each one of them, in the body just as he has desired. If they were all one member, where would the body be? But now there are many members, but one body. And I cannot say to the hand, I have no need of you. Or again, the head to the feet, I have no need of you. On the contrary, it is much truer that the members of the body, which seem to be weaker, are necessary. And those members of the body which we deem less honorable, on these we bestow more abundant honor, and our less presentable members become much more presentable. Not everything is outward. There's some things inward, amen? You have inward parts. There's inward members of your body that is just as important or more so than the outer members. Whereas our more presentable members have no need of it, but God has so composed the body, giving more abundant honor to the member which lacked. But the liver may say, I don't like it in here. It's dark. It gets hot. The kidney might say, I don't like being around all this. Well, you know what? It's wet. I don't like this. But see, that's what God designed you for. You have no rivals there. You're perfect there. That's where you are great. And that's where greatness is, because service is greatness. You can't serve outside the will. You can only serve inside the will. You can't serve outside of order. If you serve outside of order, who are you serving? Self. Amen. There's order. God has order. Jew first, the Greek second. That's, you know, Christ the first fruit, first the head, then the body, the first fruits of the first fruit. And then there's others after that. Amen. There's other parts. But there is order. It's not all the same. There's order. Left foot, not right. And if one member suffers, verse 26, all members suffer with it. If one member is honored, all the members rejoice with it. Now you are Christ's body and individual members of it. And God has appointed to the church first apostles. So that's first. He said first. So that's an order. Just like there's a first day of the week and a seventh day of the week. And see, a lot of people think that order doesn't matter. We heard on that video, and I love that video, but you know, you have to glean out some things. We understand that. Where when they came to the fourth commandment, they said, well, you know, one day in seven. God didn't say one day in seven. He said the seventh. He said, I want you to keep the day that I blessed and I sanctified at creation. Keep it holy. Congregate before me on that day. Not take one in seven, but take seven. Number seven. Amen. So there was orders. I mean, he said on the 14th day of the first month is the Passover. On the 15th day of the first month is the first day of unleavened bread. You see, on the first day of the seventh month is trumpets. On the 10th day of the seventh month is atonement. On the 15th day of the seventh month begins the Feast of Tabernacles. He has order. So if one member suffers, verse 26, all the members suffer with it. If one member is honored, all the members rejoice with it. Now you are Christ's body and individual members of it. And God has appointed in the church first apostles, second prophets, third teachers, then miracles, then gifts of healings, helps, administrations, and various kinds of tongues. You notice tongues, which we, you know, some of us possess tongues. I pray in tongues. But I understand that the gift of tongues is the least of all the gifts. I don't exalt it. I mean, in chapter 14, it says that, you know, pursue the gift of prophecy above all. All are not a prophet, apostles, are they? All are not prophets, are they? All are not teachers, are they? All are not workers of miracles, are they? But you know, if you get on Facebook, you'll see that some people think they're all teachers. Even though James said, let not many of you be teachers. And then said, women, don't you be teachers, except teaching one another. But yet they'll go, they'll run, they'll do it. It'll be all over the place. And my heart grieves because of that, really, because I see God is not honored. There's no honor there. God gave his son for us. He gave all for us. He's saving us. He's bringing us to a glorious future. And we get caught up in the temporary today, what we want today. We can't allow our godly wisdom to be corrupted by wisdom. By our reasoning or by the reasoning of the world. Because it will corrupt godly wisdom. It will. You know, you'll just think it's okay, and it won't be. All are not workers of miracles, are they? All do not have gifts of healings. All do not speak with tongues, do they? All do not interpret, do they? But earnestly desire the greater gifts. And then he goes on to say, of course, the greatest gift of all is the gift of love. Amen. Well, you know, we could think of lots of things. We could think of, you know, lots of times when people stepped out of God's order. Miriam and Aaron stepped out of God's order when Moses took a Ethiopian wife, and if they thought they were doing the right thing, but they weren't. And when God met them, God chastened them, corrected them, and then God struck Miriam with leprosy. And even though Moses begged that God would have mercy and would take that away, he refused to do so for a period of time. Said, no, she's got to stay outside the camp. Put her outside the camp. Now, the only reason why he would have done that to Miriam and not anything to Aaron was because Miriam had to be the one that stirred it up. Miriam had to be the one behind it, you know, or he would have done the same thing to Aaron. He got on to both of them, but Aaron wasn't struck with leprosy. You know, we see Korah's rebellion in Numbers chapter 16, where Korah, being a priest and a mighty man of Israel, along with 250 other mighty men, they said, we're the same as Aaron. We're the same as Aaron. We're priests too. We're all priests. We're all the same. The Bible never says that. Bible never says that anywhere. But human reasoning will corrupt godly wisdom. See? It's what that means is a hand is saying, I don't like being a hand, I'd rather be a foot. Or the ear is saying, I'm not satisfied with being an ear, I want to be the eye. So I'm just going to operate as the eye. But you know what? The ear is blind. And the eye can't hear. See, so it doesn't do any good, amen, unless we're in God's order and we fulfill the purpose for which we were created. And that's the only, look, I want God to bless this church. I want God to bless this church. I want God to bless every one of us. I want, above all, for God to be honored and Christ to be exalted. And that means his word be exalted. And that means God's wisdom upheld, received with a glad heart, not making apologies for it. People make apologies for God's word all the time. I'm not going to make apologies for it. That's a disgrace, you know, to try to, you know, form an imaginary God in your own mind because you don't like the true God, because the true God offends you a little bit. Well, he is God. And people that say, well, my God would never do this, or my God's this way, or my God's that way, that's exactly right. The problem is your God doesn't exist. And the true God, who was and is coming. Amen. And he's looking for those who are orderly and walking in the place where God has placed them in order. These things are hard. They're not easy. They're hard. And they're particularly hard because we live in a society that is absolutely, you know, opposite of this. We live in a society where it doesn't matter if there's if the husband's a woman or the wife is a man. You know, if two guys get married, two women get married, that's accepted now almost by 70% of the public, according to polls. That's accepted. You know, today, if you were to saying, if you were to go on Fox News or CNN and you were saying, well, we believe that the man is the head of the home and the head of the wife, what kind of firestorm would you start off? And they would automatically just say, now see, they think that what you're not saying is you're not equal heirs. You're not saying that. You are equal heirs. But just as today, the Jew first and then the Gentile, well, it's the same way. I mean, it's just the way it is, amen? We have to accept the way it is. And that's the way it is. And we shouldn't have any problem with that, amen? And we have now, I mean, look at the people who are preaching. Look at all the women preachers out there. It's not that what they're saying is it's not good. It's not at all. It's just that they're out of order. They're disobeying God. And you know, when Paul said in 1 Corinthians 14, he said, women are to be silent in the churches. He said, why? Because they're not permitted to speak. Now, he's not saying they can't talk. He's saying they can't teach, because we know that by what he told Timothy. But he told them to teach women and to teach the women, the men to teach the men. But they're out of their role, and that's just God's order. If they come in and they teach a mixed congregation, that's wrong. And it is a disgrace. That's what he said. It is a disgrace. And then Paul said, now, if some of you there think you're a prophet and you're spiritual, and you want to argue with this, I want you to know something. The command that I just gave you didn't come from me. It came from the Lord Jesus. And if you don't recognize it, we don't recognize you. Now, that puts fear in me. That puts fear in me, because I don't want the Lord to say, I never knew you. Depart from me. I want the Lord to say, I know you. Come in, Larry. Well done, good and faithful servant. That's what I want to hear. But we can let our wisdom, God's wisdom and God's knowledge and God's truth be corrupted by human reasoning, you know. And we think just because we got something good to say, it's okay to say it or okay to do it. No. It doesn't mean that at all. Not at all. Amen. Wisest person I know is Trion. You know, I guess because I know her. You know, I'm around her. But just because she's wise doesn't mean that she can allow her wisdom to be corrupted by human reasoning or by what is politically correct in this world. Amen. Now we'll have potluck, and then we'll have our studies. There's no testimony service this afternoon, but we'll have another one in a week or two. All right, brother, y'all rise. Donald, would you?